Hello everyone. We will discuss about recruitment and selection. Let us go through the outline of the presentation. We will discuss about introduction, purpose of and importance of recruitment, factors affecting recruitment, sources, process and methods of recruitment. Nowadays, recruitment and selection process is gaining a lot of importance because people are integral part of any organization. No organization can run without its human resources. In highly complex and competitive situation, choice of the right person at the right place has far-reaching implications. Here, this is worthy of noting. Recruitment is important because the choice of right person at the right place at the right job position is very important, and it has very far-reaching implications on the particular company. Employee well selected and well placed would not only contribute to the effective running of the organization but offer significant potential for future replacement as well. Let us go through the definition of recruitment. Recruitment is a process of searching for prospective employees and stimulating them to apply for jobs for an organization as defined by FLIPO. Recruitment forms the first stage in the process, which continues with selection and ceases with the placement of the candidate. So the first process being the recruitment, after which the selection process will take place, and final process would be the placement of the candidates. What are the purposes and importance of this recruitment process? To determine the present and future requirement of the organization's human resource. Increase the job pool of job candidates at minimum cost. Helps to increase the success rate of selection process. Helps to reduce the probability that the people or the recruited people will leave the organization soon. If you have a proper recruitment procedure in place, you can have a proper manpower policy for a long-term period. Meet the organization's legal and social obligations regarding the composition of its workforce. Being identifying and preparing potential job applicants who will be appropriate candidate for the particular job vacancy. Increase organization's individual effectiveness in the short term and long term. Evaluate the effectiveness of various recruiting techniques and sources for all types of job applicants. What are the factors influencing the recruitment? Those can be broadly classified into two categories as internal factors and external factors. The internal factors, also called as endogenous factors, are the factors within the organization that affect recruiting personnel in the organization. Internal forces, that is the factors which can be controlled by organizations. So as it says, internal factors are very much within the control of the organization, and it depends on its own recruitment policy. So here, these are the internal factors, its own recruitment policy, whether the company wants to have an internal recruitment policy or the external recruitment policy, and size of the organization, how big or small the size of the organization, that defines a particular recruitment policy of a company. Human resource planning, cost of recruitment, and growth and expansion planning of the organization. Then coming to the external forces, these are the forces which cannot be controlled by the organization. These are completely external to the company, like supply and demand of manpower, labor market, image and goodwill, political, social and legal environment prevailing in the society, and unemployment rate and competitors. These are completely external to the company, and company cannot exercise any control over these factors. Then after understanding the internal and external sources affecting the recruitment, we can go through the sources of recruitment. The searching of suitable candidates and informing them about the openings in the enterprise is the most important aspect of recruitment process. There are several sources of recruitment. Those are broadly classified as internal sources and external sources. Internal recruitment seeks applicants for position from those who are currently employed. These sources can be present employees. So present employees can be transferred to different departments within the organization. So that could be one of the possible internal source of recruitment. Promotion, the existing employees can be promoted to the various levels in the management cadre. And employee referrals, former employees and previous applicants, these all things can be considered for internal sources of recruitment. External sources of recruitment could be profession or trade associations, advertisements, employment exchange, campus recruitment, walk-ins, write-ins or talk-ins, consultants, contractors, displaced persons, radio and television, acquisition and mergers, competitors, and e-recruiting. Through all these platforms, you can reach out to the external candidates and you can hire the potential candidates. After understanding the sources, next we can understand the advantages and disadvantages of each kind of recruitment sources. So first we will take up internal sources advantages. It is less costly as you are hiring the employees from within the organization. Candidates are already oriented towards the company because they are very much aware about the company's policy and the functioning, so you don't have to spend much on their orientation and training. Organizations have better knowledge about the internal candidates. Enhancement of employee morale and motivation. Good performances rewarded. Disadvantages being, it perpetuates the old concept of doing things. It abates raiding. Candidates' current work may be affected. Politics play a greater role. Moral problems for those not promoted. So this could be one of the disadvantages, that internal people being, they are not able to get something new to the organization. Old method of, you know, functioning can be followed. External sources advantages and disadvantages are benefits of new skills, new talents and new experience to the organization. As a new candidate brings a new skill, new potential to the organization, and compliance with reservation policy becomes easy. Scope for resentment, jealousies and heartburn are avoided. Disadvantages could be better morale and motivation associated with internal recruiting is denied to the company. Maybe internal staff are demotivated when they are not considered for the promotion of the next level of their position in the management cadre. It is costly as you'll have to follow the recruitment process, you'll have to advertise, you'll have to get the applicants, and it requires a lot of budget. Chances of creeping in false positive and false negative errors. Adjustment of new employees to the organization culture takes longer time, as the new employees' orientation time will be spent by the company. So the company may have to spend little bit amount on orientation, their training, to make them familiar with the company's process. Let us go through the recruitment process. Recruitment process involves a systematic procedure from sourcing the candidates to arranging and conducting the interviews, and requires many resources and time. So once you source the candidate, you'll have to arrange them for conducting their possible interviews for possible selection. So all this process is a part of recruitment process. So here we can see the diagram. The recruitment process starts with the personal planning and the job, identify the job vacancies, then recruitment planning number types. And then before that, you'll have to do the job analysis. What kind of a job, what kind of a people you are looking for a particular job. And you'll have to also check the employee requisition. Okay, and after that, you'll have to form a strategy, develop a strategy from where, how and how are you, when are you going to source the candidates. Searching, activation, selling, message, media, you'll have to spread the message of recruitment. Then applicant pool, get the pool of applicants. Then potential hirers, you'll have to screen them, and then that goes for the selection. Then after that, you'll have to go for evaluation and control. Then it starts with a job analysis. As we have discussed before, job analysis is a process to identify and determine in detail the particular job duties and requirement and the relative importance of these duties for a given job. Job analysis is a process where judgments are made about data collected on a job. So job analysis consists of two parts, that is job description and job specification. So job description is a list that a person might use for general tasks or functions and responsibilities of a position that defines a particular job basically. Job specification is a statement of the essential component of a job class, including a summary of the work to be performed, primary duties and responsibilities, and the minimum qualifications and requirements necessary to perform the essential functions of a job. So here in the job specification, in detail, we are going to write about the primary duties, the responsibilities of the job, the qualification required to perform the job. So that goes into the job specification. Job description contains the general task and the responsibilities of a particular job position. Together, we call it as what? Job analysis. Then next we'll have to have a recruitment planning. The first step involved in the recruitment process is planning. Here planning involves to draft a comprehensive job specification for the vacant position, outlining its major and minor responsibilities, the skills, experience and qualification that you're looking for, grade and level of pay that you'll have to decide, starting date, whether temporary or permanent, the nature of employment you'll have to decide, and mention of special conditions, if any, attached to the job to be filled. So all these go into the proper recruitment planning. And next you'll have to go with the strategy development. Once it is known how many with what qualification of candidates are required, the next step involved in the regard is devise a suitable strategy for recruiting and candidates in the organization. So now we are clear with the job analysis, job description, and also we are clear with the recruitment planning. So now we'll have to develop a strategy for the recruitment process. After which we'll have to go for searching. This step involves attracting job seekers to the organization. There are two broadly sources we have already discussed, internal sources and external sources. Depending on the requirement, you can choose whether you want to go for internal sources of recruitment or external sources of recruitment. After which, the next process would be screening. Though some view screening as a starting point of selection, we have considered it as an integral part of recruitment. The reason being, the selection process starts only after the applications have been screened and shortlisted. So in the recruitment process, you'll have to screen the proper applicant resume, CVs and biodatas with suitability for the job requirement. Then evaluation and control. Given the considerable cost involved in the recruitment process, its evaluation and control is therefore imperative. It is a part of recruitment process. Proper evaluation and controlling of the pool of applications has to be done. The cost generally incurred on a recruitment process includes salary of recruiters. You have to pay compensation for the recruiters. Cost of time spent for preparing job analysis and advertisement. Administrative expenses. Cost of outsourcing or overtime while vacancies remain unfilled. Cost incurred in recruiting unsuitable candidates. Next, we'll discuss about the methods of recruitment. We have three kinds of methods, which being direct method, indirect method, and third party method of recruitment. Direct method, in this method, the representatives of the organizations are sent to the potential candidates in the educational and training institutes. They establish contacts with the candidate seeking job. So here, the organizational personnel have a direct contact with the job seekers. They can have a one-to-one interaction. So this is called as direct method of recruitment. Indirect method, it includes advertisement in newspapers, on radio and television, in professional journals, technical magazines. This method is useful when organization does not find suitable candidates to be promoted to fill up the higher post, when organization wants to reach out to vast territory, and when organization wants to fill up scientific, professional and technical post. So as we have already discussed, your recruitment policy depends on so many factors. It depends on the kind of position you are looking for, the territory you are looking for. So based on that, you can choose. So here in this indirect method, when you can't have one-to-one interaction or direct contact with the potential applicants, you can go ahead with the indirect method and you can publicize through radio, television, professional journals about the requirement in your organization. Third party method. These include the use of private employment agencies, management consultants, professional bodies or associations, employee reference, recommendations, voluntary organizations, trade unions, data banks, labor contractors, etc. to establish contact with job seekers. So you seek help from these different portals and they will help you to provide the pool of suitable candidates for the organization's requirement. This could be the examples, for example, Naukri.com, and all these are examples which are external third-party sources of recruitment. So we will stop here. The next part, the selection, we can continue with the next session.